Good morning, and welcome to the Universalist Church Online, in which love is the spirit. We are glad you are here. Whether you're joining us from around West Hartford, Connecticut, or anywhere in the world. I'm Jim, one of the trustees on the Universalist Church board. If you're attending worship through our YouTube live stream, we invite you to connect with us more deeply. Visit our webpage, www.westhartforduu.org, to learn more. There you can use the contact page to get onto our mailing list or let us know how you'd like to get involved. Our electronic communications are the best way for us to stay connected. We look forward to helping you become part of the Universalist Church, no matter where you live. Online worship can be wonderful, and technology sometimes fails us. We appreciate your graciousness when that happens. Today's order of service will appear in the Zoom chat box and the YouTube description. We'll have our fellowship time around 10:50 after worship ends. If you're attending through Zoom today, please stay online then, even if you need to step away for a short break, to connect with one another and get to know some new people too. We know it's not always easy to join a conversation with people you don't know well, but we need to keep making connections in times like these. This is a good way to do that. Today, I'd like to welcome back to our worship Reverend Yadenee Hailu. You might remember she helped us out by leading one of our summer services. Reverend Yadenee is a community minister in Tulsa, Oklahoma. She aspires to remember and then remind others in her ministry the ways of healing, which return us again and again to our nature of wholeness and harmony. She is excited to be back visiting our West Hartford community. Now, please take a moment to turn off your email and other apps, put the keyboard away, and settle in for worship.
Thank you. As we call one another from our sacred spaces in our homes and in our hearts, and as I light our chalice this morning, which is the symbol of our faith, and we're joining it with all the other Unitarian Universalists throughout the world. Please join me in speaking the words of our affirmation, our covenant. It's in the description in the chat. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another.
Good morning, everyone. Today, I adapted a story from the ancient Greek myth about Medusa into a story for all ages. It is made modern. So join me in this. Once upon a time, there's a problem with YouTube. Oh, not with me though. Okay, once upon a time in a home, I imagine, much like yours, there was a child named Medusa who loved to play. Medusa could have fun with most anything, from cardboard boxes on their way to the recycling bin, to matchbox cars, to the old family cat, Mr. Grumps. But her favorite was her handmade doll with long yarn hair and button eyes. The doll wore a cotton dress with evenly stitched embroidery her grandmother had made and was filled with wool, making her soft and easy to hold. Strangers often remarked how much the doll looked like Medusa, making her proud to have such a lovable miniature friend. Medusa took her doll everywhere she went. Her doll supervised chores and homework time, sat with her through meals, and when it was bedtime, the doll cuddled with Medusa until she fell asleep. One day, after coming home from the park, Medusa's doll with button eyes and yarn hair wasn't on her bed where she had left her. Medusa searched for her doll around the house and finally came back to her room, and she looked under her bed and was met with a horrible scene. Her precious doll, she slept, played, and ate with, her perfect friend, was ragged, ripped and torn apart, her face unrecognizable, the buttons missing, wool spilling out from her limbs, and her yarn hair in a heap, her dress ripped from her tattered body. Mr. Grumps, the family cat, had found her precious doll and destroyed her friend. Medusa couldn't stand to look at her doll this way. She was angry and sad and scared, and most of it she felt towards her doll, who was her closest friend. In her rage, she ripped what was left of her dress, and as she cried hot tears for what was gone and could not be put back together, her hands numbly pulled the remaining wool out and spread it out. Then, in her fear of getting in trouble or having to explain what happened to her favorite, most prized toy, Medusa put the scrambled and broken pieces of her doll in a box and tucked it into the corner of her closet. Far from the light of her room, she hoped the memories of her friend who could never be put back together the same would fade. She busied herself playing with boxes and cars, but not so much with Mr. Grumps anymore. A few months later, on winter break, her grandmother came over. Grandma taught Medusa how to bake cookies from scratch, how to braid her hair, and even how to crochet. Grandmas are great at doing things. Her grandma could make whole gardens from seeds that she saved through the year. She could make coasters out of broken mugs. And grandma could even take scraps of old clothes and blankets and make a quilt, which she was working on. One day, while Medusa was sitting with her grandma by the fireplace practicing her crocheting, she noticed her grandma took a break from quilting. She was taking wool that hadn't been spun into yarn and poking it again and again with a needle. "Grandma, are you fixing the wool?" Medusa asked. Grandma chuckled. "Beauty only looks broken," she said in a warm voice, "when you don't know how to move it, baby." Medusa watched the wool and needle dance between her grandma's hands, and before her eyes, the ball of wispy fluff became a plump ball, and grandma added needles into it and turned back to her quilting. Medusa thought about that, about how you need to know how to move broken to reveal beauty. The next day, she brought before her grandma the box from the corner of her closet. Grandma was quick to assess what was left of the doll Medusa had loved. She set Medusa on the yarn and told her to use it to crochet a chain stitch with it. Then, Grandma set to work with the wool that had once been the soft body of her doll. They worked by the fireplace, listening to the crackle of wood and Grandma's occasional hum of a song only she knew the tune of. When Medusa finished crocheting the yarn and saw Grandma was done too, Grandma took the fresh rope Medusa had stitched and with a couple secure stitches, put it around the mouth and neck of a beautiful white needled horse. Medusa jumped to thank her grandma for bringing restoration to that once was her best friend. You did it, Medusa rejoiced. You found the beauty. Thank you, grandma. This horse is so cute and it has reins I crocheted. That's right, baby, her grandma replied as she took the embroidered dress out of the now empty box. Can I add this as a square on my quilt, Medusa, to remind us of our time together? That would be beautiful, Medusa sang, growing confident in the possibilities available with trained hands ready to reimagine, to listen, and to move. Thank you.
Please join me now in singing our doxology. We are grateful for all the ways in which you support us and support one another. In this ongoing time of challenges and opportunities, the need for our beloved communities of justice, wisdom, and love has only become more apparent. As one of the ways we serve the wider world, we share our general offering each week with organizations that are in harmony with our values, who do work in the world that brings us ever closer to creating that beloved community that we aspire to. This month, we share our offering with Maria C. Colon Sanchez Elementary School in Hartford, Connecticut. The pandemic has made life more difficult for so many people, and it has really upended the lives of teachers and students in our communities. Sanchez is a public elementary school in Hartford that we've helped to support for many, many years now, particularly with our holiday book drive. This is a moment when our support will help the school and its community once again, especially as the pandemic picks up. Because sharing our plate has worked so well, we're planning to continue this practice, which means we need more ideas for organizations that we can help support with our generosity. So you'll find a survey in the weekly e-newsletter that came to you this past Friday. We'll keep sharing it for a while, the survey that is, so that you can suggest organizations with whom we might share our resources. So please fill out the survey. Let us know who you would like us to support through sharing our general offering. As we begin our time of prayer and reflection, let us open our hearts to the concerns of people of this community and those beyond it. This day, I'd like to call to our minds and hearts the following. Ivan L. is still doing well. His recovery will be over the course of the next 3 to 4 months. It is a slow but sure process, and he and Nora truly appreciate all the concern and care they have received. They both are deeply grateful. Judy B. has been following her cardiologist's orders and spending time resting, reading, and writing notes to people. She too is very grateful to our community for showing her such care and compassion as she continues to recover. Friday was the Transgender Day of Remembrance for our neighbor church, the Metropolitan Community Church. Reverend Aaron thanks all of us for being present for their celebration and supporting their work in our community. As we gather this week, in particular on Thursday, in new and safe ways for this 2020 Thanksgiving, I'd ask all of us to not only hold close our family members, but those among us who are further separated from one another because of our misguided belief in our powers of nation building at the cost of other nations and cultures. Let us remember in particular our Indigenous brothers and sisters and their trail of tears that was done during Thanksgiving time several years ago, and their forcible removal from their own native lands. Let us hold close the 545 children that still have not been reunited with their parents because of our failed border ideologies. Let us also call to mind our sisters and brothers of color who, at the hands of systematic white supremacy and individual racists, have been killed this year from January to this very day. Finally, let us remember all the families of the over 1.34 million families that will be missing someone from their Thanksgiving because of the pandemic. May we be grateful for all that we have and all that we are as this week of international gratitude is celebrated. Amen and blessed be.
Hello, everyone. My grandmother, who never received education beyond the eighth grade, was a very wise woman. She had many great instincts, and one of hers was that every day she would stretch before she went to bed, and she would tell me that she was imagining her favorite place. She would visit her favorite places in her mind to relax her body. And I would like to invite you now to close your eyes or get in a position that is comfortable for you and visit your favorite place. The feeling it gives you, not just to imagine it, but to feel it in your body. If you don't have a favorite place, you can join me in mine. I'll describe it out loud in this meditation. Taking a deep breath, I begin to hear the ocean waves in the distance. They are soft and consistent. I feel the warmth of the sun on my shoulders and my back. I can feel the sand crunching in between my feet as I walk towards the waves. I can see glistening along the shoreline. And I feel at home. The waving branches of the palms distract me, and I notice that there are birds chirping, and there's coconuts fresh, and everything just seems to welcome ease. I take a few deep breaths here. Thank you for visiting your favorite place and giving your nervous system the vacation it always wants.
Reading this morning is a selection from Waking the Tiger, Healing Trauma by Anne Frederick and Peter Levine. Every trauma provides an opportunity for authentic transformation. Trauma amplifies and evokes the expansion and contraction of psyche, body, and soul. It is how we respond to a traumatic event that determines whether trauma will be a cruel and punishing Medusa, turning us into stone, or whether it will be a spiritual teacher, taking us along vast and uncharted pathways. In the Greek myth, blood from Medusa's slain body was taken in two vials. One vial had the power to kill, while the other had the power to resurrect. If we let it, trauma has the power to rob our lives of vitality and destroy it. However, we can also use it for powerful self-renewal and transformation. Trauma resolved is a blessing from a greater power.
Thank you.
Wow. Oh, wow. That was amazing. I feel so energized. It is good to be back with y'all. Oh my goodness. The music has been amazing. This working with the staff you have here at West Hartford, y'all, I want to share is a joy. And so it is very good to be back. And the world has changed a good 25 times since last I was here 4 months ago. Oh my gosh. Is that just 4 months? It feels like years. Oh my gosh. So I come with another reflection from my adolescence, but due to this topic of trauma, which I'm diving into today, I will be sharing both a personal story and a mythic story, and I wanna give a care warning. So I will be mentioning emotional breakdown and a reference to physical violence. And if that is a tender subject for your nervous system, I take no offense in you taking care of yourself, however that means. I hope by the end, It's going to get rough before it gets better, but I hope by the end of our sermon today, we find paths and have invitations to find our ways back to the light of a clear blue morning again, and to feel again in our bodies that everything just might be all right. It may be okay again. So my first story, I'll start with myself. Well, I was 18, and it was only a year or so after I built my altar that I mentioned last time I was here, and I had first entered therapy, CBT, cognitive behavioral, or talk therapy is how it's commonly known. And after months of weekly sessions, I came to a messy emotional eruption. I was coming every Monday, spending money I barely had, telling a stranger who I didn't feel understood me or my background or my cultures, all of my sadness. And week after week, she would ask me about another year, every consensual year of my life up to that point, and get more and more details from that year, all for her just to take notes and repeat what I said and conclude I was clinically depressed and I had been a lot of my childhood. It was probably the depression. Hell, I knew I wasn't happy. I was aware of that. But the remedy she seemed to pose was spill more pain, explain more of my chaos, come back on Monday, do it again. It was hell with no sure date. Trauma, I thought bitterly. The gift that just keeps on freaking giving when I went to my car. I began to spiral as I turned on my car after a session and on my drive home, completely emotionally overwhelmed in the pain of memories being regurgitated and sadness being explained and the bitterness at it only hurting more and more that I explained why I was right, why I was justified to have a wall so thick and sealed over my heart, I began to scream. Y'all, it was an emotional eruption that I have not had the likes of before. I had never screamed so hard, for so loud, for so long before in my life, and I definitely should not have been driving a car, but there I was on the highway, driving to my unheated studio apartments with only cereal for food, 35 minutes away, screaming, wishing I could find my voice. Wishing I could feel something other than pain, and fairly sure I was losing my mind. This is an intense memory for me to dredge up and share, but I have to give you some context. So it was on this car ride, while I was screaming and crying, shaking my head, wanting my voice to come out, my shoulders, and then I was so sick and tired of being stuck and tired that in my mind's eye flashed an image before me. It was a medieval knight, the ones that some people have in their houses that kind of look scary. Well, that medieval knight was with heavy armor and it was sealed at every joint. Even the face shield thing was locked down and the armor was covered with barnacles of all things. The things that are stuck on the bottom of boats, well, they were hard and sharp and really stuck all over on them. And I knew that this armored monster with barnacles, this monster is what I felt I was created into. Supposedly young and expected to be lovable at 18, this is really what I looked like. This is how my heart felt, my body felt in the world. I was cold, lifeless, rigid, armored, jagged, covered in barnacles that drew blood from anyone daring to try and get close to me. I hated the monster I felt I was. Screaming and crying and shaking still and unfortunately driving, I suddenly realized clearly that I was in there. I wasn't the armor. I was locked in the armor. Me was really soft skin, flesh, human, with organs easily pierced by a sword. So a soft me is who crawled into that armor as a last-ditch effort to survive the psychological and emotional pain of many parts of my childhood. And I was just stuck in it now, unsure how or if I could get out. I stopped screaming, and silent tears streaked my cheeks as I was rocking and moaning when I realized some more, just looking at this image in my mind. First, that I got into this protection, and now that I'm away from the powerlessness that demanded, I needed to choose and train myself to not wear hell every day. And maybe then I wouldn't feel like I was living in it. With this realization, the super glued mask came off of the image, and I could see myself, my face at least, human, inside a steel suit. Then second, with the ability to take off the armor, I realized the armor is a tool. When I had seen the person who was the source of a lot of my protection, or when I was in the circumference of any narcissist miles away, I knew how to protect myself. My soft organs, my warm flesh, me in this car started to take conscious breaths, deep breaths, as I explained to myself, armor is an option, not my body's cage. I can wear other things. I can explore other ways to present my soft skin self. And like the rest of my wardrobe, I use the pieces that meet the needs I have for the environment. I felt options. I felt expansion. I felt hope. I felt relief. And with a sore throat, I felt heard and seen. This was my first experience with somatic experiencing. Somatic experiencing is a body-based trauma healing process that allows the body, which is the storehouse of our memories, especially traumatic ones, to lead the healing process. Because luckily, the body not only remembers, it also naturally, instinctually knows how to discharge the trapped energy known as trauma in our bodies. It would have been ideal if I had a skilled facilitator there to doula that emotional eruption, but luckily, I threw caution to the wind, y'all, in my hysteria, and I dropped into my body completely. And I was able to discharge some stuck energy, preventing or really protecting me from healing. And it was from then on that I actually started to feel alive. Depression became seasonal instead of a sentence, a life sentence. So whether we rub dirt in it, shrug it off or fall apart, trauma lives in our bodies, frozen and demanding to be liberated. It can take the form of vicious and eerie cycles that we repeat in our life or through generations, or physical pain or unimaginable emotions like rage or fear or shame just right under the surface of our conscious. I've learned that trauma is not some elite experience for those who've gone to war or have been in the news. There isn't a minimum requirement for what can get stuck in our bodies and short-circuit our body's ability to discharge, fight or flight, and return to a relaxed state. Dr. Peter Levine, who introduced this trauma discharging process as science — it's been in our bodies for millennia, but he introduced it as a scientific process and is the founder of the somatic experiencing method — says, quote, "Trauma is not what happens to us, but what we hold inside in the absence of an empathetic witness. Trauma is not what happens to us, but what we hold inside in the absence of an empathetic witness," end quote. Somatic therapy follows sensations in the body and moves at the pace of the body, allowing the body to process, then integrate traumatic experiences. Healing is our path back to wholeness, into our humanity. This process takes place mostly in the amygdala and hippocampus, that middle part, large part of our brains, the mammalian part of our brains, where memories are made, are interpreted and stored, where emotions are identified and assigned to memories. It's an important part of our brain. In this space, trauma can be processed in primal ways. That talk therapy, which utilizes the prefrontal cortex, can be very powerful, but cannot do what the mammalian part of our brain can do. The mammalian part of our brain is where our sense of space and feeling reside, and will often sort of describe what is happening, not with words, but with pictures and symbols. This is one reason mythic tales are so powerful through centuries and cultures. That is using a primal mammalian part of our brains. Last week, I learned the backstory of Medusa. I was inspired because it was mentioned in the reading that I selected. And did y'all know the backstory of that snake-haired mutant? Did you know there was more to this personality? I sure didn't, and I want to share it with y'all, but because of its very harsh plot, I modified it into a story for all ages earlier, so you will notice parallels with the doll earlier. So I'm going to give it to you now, though. So Medusa was born looking mostly human, and she was gorgeous. She aspired and became a lead priestess in the temple for Athena, the goddess of her city. What a fantastic human! In the service for to the most holy thing in her, to Athena. And then Poseidon, a ruthless demigod, chased her and violated Medusa inside the temple. Destroying her security. As she cried out for help, no one came, and she lost her identity and her sense of security in the world. After Poseidon left, the trauma festered, and Athena, the goddess, returns to the temple and is horrified to see Medusa violated and her temple stained with the crime. And much like many of us do in our grief and terror, she directed it towards her most precious thing, Medusa, innocent Medusa. She turned her into a reptilian mutant with snakes for hair. Now anyone who looks into her soul, into her eyes, they become a frozen reflection of the petrified Medusa, who was locked in a freeze response when violated by Poseidon. Medusa exiles herself, feeling unworthy or able to be with anyone and not cause harm. When warriors come to attack her or even accidentally stumble on her ruins of a home, with one glance, they turn like stone. And she sees the terror frozen in their statue faces, the trauma her body has become a house to constant reliving. Her environment is a museum with statues of pain. It is only later that a warrior seeks Athena, the goddess's help. Athena gives him her shield, which is polished so well it becomes a mirror. There is some fun symbolism there about the greatest protection being self-reflection, but that is for another sermon, which I will write and I'm excited about. Back to the story. The warrior uses this shield to look at Medusa through the reflection. And with his unique perspective, he beheads the tortured Medusa. From her torn body, magic children she couldn't bring forth come out. First, a giant with a golden sword who is literally never really mentioned again in Greek mythology, goes off, lives a great life, I'm sure. And then the second child is Pegasus, the very popular winged white horse, which has the strength to fly to Mount Olympus multiple times. Pegasus, who releases a ground spring, which becomes a stream of water, which provides creative inspiration, music, and art for many. Pegasus, when rode with Athena's golden reins, is a vital part in battling a chimera who was terrorizing a city. Pegasus becomes immortalized in a constellation by Zeus himself for its service and lives on as a symbol of freedom and endless creativity and beauty. Now, there are many ways to unpack that core story I just shared. We could talk about the system of consequences needed for Poseidon. Heck, we could talk about the system of protection that should have been in place for Medusa to never have ever been harassed, let alone violated. There's a lot that this story brought up in me initially, but I want to bring up 2 points specifically about trauma. First, I want us to recognize our impulse to survive is not evil. The instinct to fight or flight or freeze or even collapse are evolutionary gifts. They are gifts programming survival at best or painless death at worst. It is a gift from our ancestors. The adrenaline flooding, hyper attentive, sense calculating, heart rushing rush is the guttural lunge to life itself. It sucks to be stuck in it, but it is a gift. The horrid catch for being an animal evolved to have metaconsciousness like ourselves with our fancy prefrontal cortexes is that this programming to make sense of threats and danger can cut off our mammalian brains and their chance to disarm the defenses and return to our rested state. So often overthinking actually interrupts our animal instincts from completing their cycle. Trauma is the body stuck in high alert and defense, which is unnatural. And like I did with my poor self-image growing up and reputation as an angry child, or Athena did by turning Medusa into the monster she grievously concluded she was, in the attempt to make sense of intense and overwhelming experiences, we often implode and villainize ourselves to protect ourselves. If you already have flashes of the monster, the personalities inside us that we resent, that you resent of yourself, the parts of you you wish to exile, I want to invite you to imagine that part of you, the rager, the whiner, the screamer, the crybaby, the apathetic, the silent, whoever. They are a piece of you trying to protect your gift, your soul, your best thing from being destroyed by neglect or by overwhelm or by abuse. Imagine holding that this week or month or year and journal about it. Imagine looking at your monsters through the reflection of your highest self, your most easeful, purposeful, blissful self, just looking at this part of you, doing its best to protect you. As you contemplate that, I want to add that this messy but well-intentioned side of ourselves that we are so quick to call broken beyond repair or a monster to send away also hold the power that once we face and allow to transform can become a source of strength for a more full life. Medusa's reptilian face became an emblem on Athena's shield after she was killed. The very one which aided in her liberation. And her head, Medusa's, like the literal head that was cut off, that was kept and was used in multiple battles. Her gaze still potent to protect the light and destroy ignorance. I, this year, was surprised to revisit my armored self from years ago while working with an actual somatic therapist this time. I was not driving, luckily. And for the first time, I thought it was a complete mistake to see this version of myself again, this archetype. I thought I was dealing with unrelated issues, as we often do, but they're all connected. But when I was willing to sit and see and feel what she offered, affection warmed my anxious heart when she simply sat down and gestured for water. After resting, this renewed energy, this armored version of myself with no helmet on, got up and returned to a long line of Yadenees in many outfits with various skill sets. My armor, my defense strategy through healing and processing, through witness and experiencing, has become an option, not a cage. It knows how to come out, how to rest and return. And she has finally been allowed to complete her cycle, to come home when necessary and leave when the threat is gone. And I wish this rebirth, this relief, this realization for us all. Second, about the Medusa story I want to point out, it's a rich one. The original goodness is not lost by the cruelty of others. Your original goodness, your original gift, your original joy, beauty, truth is not lost by the cruelty of others. Medusa is not only a symbol of survival alone. What birthed from her release was new possibilities. The giant with a gold sword goes off to live a life and explore things we can't even imagine. Like the doll's dress from our story earlier, has become a square on her grandmother's quilt and goes off to spread beauty beyond that child's world. There are some things in us that when released, ripple out into the unknown. And there are also parts of us when freed, which enrich our inner world, as well as the lives of those close to us. The grandmother needled her grandchild, a white horse, out of the wool. And Medusa's son, in the story, is Pegasus, whose name is related to the English verb and season, spring. Pegasus brings freedom, expansion, and life, and so much creativity, much like the completion of a trauma cycle, brings expansion, relief, and psychological benefits that spring out of our sense of self and relationships and our life. Out of our world, stuck and frozen response, liberation wants to be born. A new way of being wants to be set free, but it doesn't come with head knowledge alone or outwitting others. It comes by moving through the dark nights of our soul, witnessing our wisdom, trusting our bodies, and witnessing what has been festering in aloneness with kindness. after my screaming, shaking fit back when I was 18, and every time since that I have followed my body's instincts to release energy, I found myself looking around at the world around me with new eyes, much like our song from Dolly Parton earlier. This year, after a somatic release with my therapist, I told her, I can hear music playing, and the world seemed to be shimmering. It was trippy. The closest version of this euphoria from trauma discharge I can akin this to is anyone who has who wears glasses and has received a fresh eyeglass prescription may recall the experience. When I was a kid, I would press my face against the window of the car with my new glasses and yell, "Mom, we can see leaves on trees? You can do that? All of them? They're beautiful!" All the way home. Anyone who's received a fresh eyeglass prescription can relate, but I hope anyone can recall an experience where they felt deep relief. The kind where every muscle in your face and your neck remember to soften without you commanding them to. Your body opens to ease and the beauty all around. And the warmth of joy returns to your skin now that it is safe. So I say again, with humility, but not with hate, as I did the first time, trauma can be a gift that keeps on giving. I am not saying, I want everyone to hear me, I am not saying seek trauma for greater life wisdom or something. Do not hear that. That is not me. Do not put that on me. I refuse. That is not what I'm saying. I am, however, uplifting that if you simply process what life brings you, healing, that process can become a gift which keeps on giving. Trauma gives by repeating and re-attempting resolve, and by re-presenting itself to be identified, to be processed, to be integrated. By clawing, fighting, screaming, digging, it's not very cute how trauma does it, but it's way to our awareness so it can be seen with a new perspective, one from the reflection of our highest nature so it can be liberated and bring forth medicine, not just for us, but for the whole community. The freedom that comes from movement, the purpose that comes from service, to something greater and holy, the nourishment and joy that comes from inspiration, from creativity and art. This expansion, this relief, this transformation and new dimensions and possibilities are what are born from our worst secrets, locked in our bodies when released. The wound seeking healing and playing out in all of our relationships and even our body's health. I do not invite you into the dark night of your soul, into the reclamation of who you truly are in the midst of staring at the monster you feel you've become out of obligation. I don't invite you because it's quick or clean. In fact, it is muddy and rough. I invite you because as an aspiring oracle for healing and wholeness, as a returning warrior for my soul, I've made the trek again and again and again and again, and I'm pretty sure I have quite a few more times before I leave this earth. I faced Medusa straight on and I've been frozen for it. I've, with guidance and growing skills, have strategically witnessed Medusa and befriended the monster within me, liberated them from their narrow role inside, and I've set them free and have brought the medicine back to my life, to my relationships, to my body, to my service, and I wish the same for all of us. Trauma specialist Peter A. Levine says, quote, "Trauma is hell on earth. Trauma resolved is a gift from the gods." I invite you to master the path of healing and wholeness so that you too may unleash your gift, that you can uncover beauty from what seems broken by learning how to move it. For it is justice, for if it is justice or beauty that you desire to see in our world, you must cultivate it inside yourself first. May it be so. Much love.
Thank you.
Let us speak together our unison benediction. Engage with the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return to no person evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering and honor all beings.